Welcome to Assassin's Creed The Complete Story. We're coming to the close of arguably one of the greatest assassins to live. This is his last episode, so I hope you're still watching. There is one question we've never addressed, and I figured this would be as good a time as any to ask it. The arm blade, do you think it's an actual viable weapon, or is it just a really cool thing from the video games? When we last left off, Ezio had finally resolved everything, except the mystery of the first civilization and what the Assassin's Order's true purpose is. He found a note from his uncle Mario detailing a sealed library beneath the Assassin's Fortress in Masyaf. In May of 1510, Ezio set off from Rome, and it would take him some time, a few pirate fights, and a few stops for repairs, but he would eventually travel to Cyprus and explore a Templar archive there. But eventually he realized that the authorities were interfering with his journey, and he would continue on his own. It would be nearly a year before he would finally set foot in Masyaf, and the first thing that he would notice is that the town is falling apart and largely abandoned. As he made his way to the old assassin fortress, he would get jumped by the Byzantine Templar commander. Outnumbered, they would walk him to the fortress's plank up in the watchtower. Could this already be the end of one of our greatest assassins? Nope, Ezio returns the favor to the commander at the last second and ties the noose around his neck before fleeing the area. He would slip into the basement of the old assassin's fortress, and there he would find the library door. But it was sealed as expected. The Templars were making headway with opening it though, and the garrison commander that he just pissed off had the journal explaining the location of the keys. Ezio would find the commander in a carriage, and a chase would commence as Ezio tried to kill the commander to take the journal. He would manage to do that just in time as they reached a nearby village. Following the journal, Ezio would make for Constantinople in hopes of beating the Templars to the next key. Once he docked, he would be greeted by the local assassin leader, Yusef. He would inform Ezio of the state of the city, how the Byzantine were fighting with the Ottomans for control of the city right now. Finding all of that interesting, Ezio kind of had his goal in mind, and he would go to the local Polo bookstore to get his clues. And it is there that he would meet with Sophia, the woman who will eventually become his wife, and the owner of this bookshop where the first key is resting beneath. After getting the first key, Ezio would then hang around the city while the assassins helped him track down the other keys. He would aid Prince Suleiman and keep him from being assassinated while obtaining the four other keys in Constantinople. He would then travel to Cappadocia as the last key was being kept there and it was in one man's hands. But he wouldn't leave before destroying the great chain that they were using to keep him confined in the city after the trouble that he had started protecting the prince. Once arriving at Cappadocia, he would attempt to make contact with the spies who had gotten him the information. However, he learned that most of them had been discovered and captured by the Byzantines. He was arriving just in time to prevent the last of them from being captured. Of course, saving them meant engaging the Byzantines in open combat. This would start a panic in the city, but Ezio would make this panic even greater by destroying the city's ordnance supplies. He then would begin to chase the man who held the last key. Since everyone was panicking, no one could stop him. Isn't he a genius? Upon killing and claiming the last of the keys, Ezio would find himself confronted by Suleiman's uncle and the heir apparent to the Ottoman throne, Ahmet. Ahmet demanded the keys, stating that he was in fact a Templar, and if Ezio did not give him the keys, harm would fall on Sophia. Pissed off beyond belief, Ezio pledged vengeance should any harm come to her. Ezio didn't give up the keys though, and now he was worried about Sophia's life. Upon arriving back at the bookstore where Sophia should be, he found no one there but Yusef, whom he had asked to keep an eye on Sophia until he returned. But Yusef was killed. Ezio would then gather up the remaining keys being kept at the bookstore, and he headed off to the exchange. At the meeting spot, Ezio thought he would be able to get one over on the Templars, but they managed to trick him! Ahmet took the keys from Ezio, and Sophia wasn't even there! She was being hung in the courtyard. Ezio would then use a parachute to get down to the courtyard just in time to save Sophia. But no time for a long thank you, Ezio jumped on the nearest carriage to make for the library. Maybe he could still stop Ahmet. The two carriages would eventually meet up on the cliffside and they would start having a fight, until both carriages are knocked off the cliff and both men would fall. But luckily, both of them survived, and as they stood up, they saw the army arriving with Selim heading the way. Selim walked up to Ahmet and stated that the Sultan chose Suleiman over Ahmet, and he strangled Ahmet right there. He then went to Ezio. Worried that he was going to be next, Ezio didn't know what to do and he was panicking. But Selim stated that Ezio was free to go, as he had heard good things from Suleiman about him. But he warned, don't return to Constantinople ever again. Not one to overstay his welcome, Ezio took Sophia with him and they went to Masyaf to open the library finally. But what did he find after everything he had been through? Not books. No. he found the remains of Altair in a memory seal. The seal would explain where Altair had hidden his apple so long ago. Moving towards it, Ezio decided not to take it. No, he had seen too much in his life. He then spoke to Desmond by speaking into the open air, knowing that Desmond would eventually see this. He acknowledged that he was a conduit for messages to Desmond, and nothing more. He removed his bracers, and he put his sword down to declare that he was done being an assassin. He could do this no more. He encouraged Desmond to make all of his life's sufferings worth something, and listen. Listen to what they have to tell him. Sophia and Ezio would go back to Constantinople one more time, and they would set up the new assassin leader there and place the Masyaf keys back beneath the bookshop that Sophia once ran. This is the end, isn't it? Not quite, my listeners, because as you see, Ezio still has one more tale. Ezio would take Sophia back to Venice where he married her, and they had a daughter and a son. They then lived together on the countryside managing a vineyard. In 1519, he would suffer a chest infection, which would result in a serious cough. He would also go see his old friend, Leonardo da Vinci, as he passed on. It was in 1524 that Ezio would have his last adventure. One day, while tending to the vineyard, a woman in a cloak approached his daughter. Panicked, Ezio would rush to her and grab her by the collar, only to see an assassin insignia. The woman would introduce herself as Xiao Jun, the Chinese assassin who had traveled to Ezio to learn the methods of uniting the assassins in her homeland. Ezio refused to get involved again. I mean, he was retired after all. But the next day he found Jun reading a letter he was writing in his study, and he angrily demanded that she leave the vineyard. Jun would recite the words from his journal, and Ezio would finally relent, inviting her to run errands with him in Florence that day. It was there that he would explain that it was about the importance of love in the assassin order. That is, if she could not support what inspired hope in her people, she would not succeed. But before they could talk for very long, they were ambushed by Chinese imperial soldiers. Jun explained that she was actually a concubine before joining the assassin order, and they were here to take her back. After defeating them in Florence, the attackers would follow them back to Ezio's vineyard, where they would have to defend and defeat them again finally. But not before our elderly Ezio took a rather heavy blow to the chest. The next day, Jun would thank Ezio, and she would leave. Ezio knew the end was coming. His cough was getting worse, and his chest hurt worse than ever. In his final moments, he chose to go to Florence with Sophia and his daughter. While they shopped, he would sit in the nearby bench to relax. Sophia would say that he should have stayed home if he felt this ill. But Ezio would reply with, "I am home." It is here that our great assassin would finally pass on, sitting in the city he loved, looking at his family that he finally got to have. Ezio would pass to his chest infection. Oddly, it was only released with certain special editions, so not everybody got to watch this. Well, that closes out Ezio, leaving us with only three more assassins. But it's time to wrap up a few stories so that we can get ready for some more requests. Did anybody say Final Fantasy VII? Or maybe God of War? Or Tekken? What do you guys think we should be moving on to next as we wrap up BioShock and Castlevania? Thank you for watching, and I'll see you guys next time here at Eligible Monster.